Well, good morning once again and welcome to our online service from King's Christian Centre here in Mold in North Wales. We're very pleased that you're able to join us for our service and we look forward to worshipping together, to praying together, to listening to the Word of God and growing in faith, growing in grace, growing in our knowledge of Christ together as a fellowship. Liz, I believe you have a reading to start us off.
We have. I was reading this earlier and decided to share it with you. It's Paul writing a letter to Timothy as a young pastor. So he's speaking about himself, giving advice to Timothy. And this is what he says in 1 Timothy 1, verse 15. This is a trustworthy saying and everyone should accept it. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I'm the worst of them all. But God had mercy on me so that Christ Jesus could use me as a prime example of his great patience with even the worst sinners. Then others will realise that they too can believe in him and receive eternal life. All honour and glory to God for ever and ever. He is the eternal King, the unseen one who never dies. He alone is God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Liz. Well, before we turn to our first worship songs, let's just pray together, commit this time to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you've bid us to come into your presence with boldness, not because of what any good things about us, Lord, but because of what Jesus has done for us. So, Father, we come into your presence now and we ask that you will bless us, Lord. Bless all who are joining in with this service, wherever or whenever they're watching. Pray that your Holy Spirit will move through our lives, move through our fellowships, and will bring your kingdom blessings to bear in our land. Commit this time to you now, Heavenly Father, in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Well, the first part of our service is all about blessings, and the two songs that we're about to sing mirror that. So join in, enjoy, and just take on board the words that we're singing. Make them your prayer as we sing these two songs together.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the again. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Come, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never.
Your kingdom shall not pass away. ancient of days. My Lord, how ancient of days. Ooh, yeah. Oh!
Now to turn to prayer, and for day for this week's prayer time, we're going to use a prayer strategy that I learnt a few years ago at a place called Faldebrennen, and the scripture behind it goes like this. We start off in Numbers chapter 6, where the Lord God tells Moses this. The Lord said to Moses, we're in verse 22, then the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron and his sons to bless the people of Israel with this special blessing. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. Whenever Aaron and his sons bless the people of Israel in my name, I myself will bless them. Now, back in the day when this was written, Aaron and his sons were the priests. They were the ones who were the intermediaries between the people of Israel and God. And God has made this wonderful promise to the priests that whenever they bless the people of Israel in God's name, God will bless them. Now we fast forward 1300 years. Whoa, this is a marvellous book, isn't it? The whole of history is in here. To 1 Peter chapter 2. And Peter is now talking to us. Christians, people who've accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Saviour and Lord and put their faith in him for their salvation. And this is what Peter says to us. You are a chosen people. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. Do you see the connection there? The connection is the priesthood. Now, we all know that every promise that God has ever made is yes and amen in Christ Jesus. So that same promise that God made to Aaron and his sons, who were the priests back in Moses' day, is just as valid today for us who are a royal priesthood today. So we are able to proclaim blessing over our people and trust that God will fulfill his promise and bring those blessings to pass. So that's just what we're going to do now. Liz is going to proclaim blessings over our nation and over global issues. I'm then going to proclaim blessings over more local and personal things. But you at home and you watching online, you can do this too. If you're a Christian, if you've put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, then this promise is for you as well. So you can start proclaiming blessings over things in your life, maybe your family, your work situation, your finances, your health, whatever needs blessing from God, you can proclaim that blessing for yourselves. So don't just rely on us to do that for you. You can come to God and do that yourself. But Liz, perhaps you'll lead us off.
So, Father God, we come to you and we know that this world is a mess, all of it. And we feel helpless. And you, as creator, must be heartbroken at the state of what your creation has become, the destruction and the evil that goes on unrestrained. And Lord, because we are helpless, we come to you and we ask, Father, that you will step in. And we ask that you will bless the leaders of the countries of this world, that you will bless the peoples who are persecuted and struggling with famine and starvation, that you will bless the climate situation, that rain will be restored where it needs to be to bring crops to people who are starving and children who are dying. Father, we ask that you will again stretch out your hand in blessing over this world, that globally there will be a turning to you, Father, that globally people will recognise that you are God, King of kings and Lord of lords, the only God and Saviour. Father, we just are helpless and hopeless without you. And we plead with you for your blessings once more upon this world. And Lord, we live in a corner of the world known as the United Kingdom. And we're in a mess as well. Father, the people, you tell us to pray for our leaders, but our leaders are in disarray. They don't really seem to know who is leading and what should be happening. We've just had a new king. Father, we pray blessings on King Charles, that he may stand as a man of character and honour in the middle of this situation. And Father, we pray that your blessing will yet fall on the United Kingdom, on Scotland and Northern Ireland, on Wales and on England, on every part of it, Father. Your people, wherever they are dwelling, Father, I pray that we will rise up and that we will beseech you for your blessings upon our country once again, that we may turn, that people will turn to you, that we may turn to you consistently in prayer for our nation and our leaders, for leaders to have the right leaders, new leaders, your appointment, Father, not the voting ticket. Lord, we plead with you for your blessing upon the current situation in Westminster, that in this next week, as we wait to see what people think is the right thing to do, that you will intervene, that your blessing will be upon the decisions that are made, that you will prevent the destruction that the enemy would wreak in our country, that you will bless us. Father, we plead with you for blessings and we speak the name of Jesus over our country, over our government, over the mechanism of government and over the leadership decisions. And we ask it in the mighty name of Jesus that you will bless us. Amen.
Amen. So, Father, we give you thanks and praise for the authority and responsibility that you have given us as your children to be your priests. And with that authority, in the precious name of Jesus, I speak out blessing over this town, over this area of Northeast Wales. Pray that salvation will spring up from the ground here. Pray that you will heal our land, Lord, as we turn to you in prayer. We pray for the churches and the Christians embedded in our society. Pray that we will be the salt and light that brings your kingdom values and kingdom ethos into the lives of our friends, our neighbours, our work colleagues, our friends at school. We speak blessing, Father, over your people and an outpouring of your Spirit, Lord, that will revive us and will bring many more into your kingdom. We speak blessing, Father, over families in this land. We know, Father, that the family is instituted by you. So we speak blessing over our families, Father, especially those who are in turmoil and hurting and breaking up and having all sorts of problems, Father. We speak the blessings of your kingdom into those families. And for our local government here, Father, in Northeast Wales, our councillors, our police chiefs and people like that, Father, we speak blessing over them too, in the precious name of Jesus. And Father, we thank you once again that we can do this, that we can invoke the blessings of heaven on earth because of what Jesus has done for us. Amen.
Amen.
Before the throne.
Time for the Word of God, and the person who's going to deliver the message today is a friend of this church. It's Alan Biswas Rooney. He was here as an intern years ago, and he has just taken up a new appointment in Scotland as a Baptist minister. And obviously, we want to hear about that, and we want to bless him and his family as they move into ministry. And as Alan comes on the screen, he's first of all going to tell us a little about that, and then he will preach to us. So I'm going to pray for him and his family and the Word of God now, and then we will sit back and hear what God has to say through Alan. Father, thank you for Alan and Zoe and Micah. Thank you that they have been part of this family here in Mould. And we're still connected, Father, because that's what happens in your family. You make us family and we stay connected. And we just want to bless them as they start this new position up in Scotland, which is Alan's home country. Father, bless them, provide for them, give him good success in his ministry. May he have people to support him, give them friends, give Zoe people to be friends with. Bless Micah as he grows up in this country. Father, we pray that your will be done in their life, in that church, and with the people of Paisley, and that your name will be glorified. And as we sit and listen to him today, Father, we pray that the Word of God will go out with authority and with power. It's always the truth, because it's your Word. And I pray that you will open our hearts to hear what it is you want us to do with that today. And we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. Thank you so much for allowing me to join with you today and allow me to share with you in God's word, in which I'll be looking at Luke chapter 11 verses 5 to 13. And today's theme, or today's title, as shameless prayer. Now, on the topic of prayer, I feel that it would be important for me to reiterate my thanksgiving to everyone at King's for your continued prayers. Thank you for your prayers when Zoe was unwell last November. Thank you for your continued prayers for her healing. And I can say now that actually Zoe's health is back to normal. She's doing amazingly. Micah's doing amazingly. I'm doing amazingly. And yeah, we just want to thank you for just remembering us in your prayers. I also want to give you a little update as to, and it's the reason as to why I won't be with you, that I'm not with you today. As some of you are, aware, when I came to preach last at King's Christian Centre, the following Sunday, I was due to come to Paisley to a church called Hope Hall Evangelical Church to preach and to be interviewed for the role as of senior pastor or pastor here. Now, over the couple of months, I'm waiting to find out actually if this is where God is calling us as a family. We're just waiting, praying and seeking God's face until we found out that they would like to offer me the job. So as they offered me the job, the next step was to look for properties in Scotland, in Paisley, or the immediate surrounding areas, in which what we found is that the property market, the rental market, was very, very challenging in Paisley at the moment. So we ended up finding a property in which the landlord encouraged us to move in as soon as possible, he was able to have people in his property, really. So we took that flat. We love the flat. It's incredible inside, but it is temporary, as the church has a manse that will become available within the next couple of months, in which we'll be moving into. So first of all, I just want to thank you for your support over me, how you've been friends with me, how you've helped me navigate God's calling in my life, how you it was during my time at King's, how you helped me grow as a leader. And for me, I genuinely believe that right now, me as a pastor is a manifestation of the investment that was placed into me, not just at Bible College, but also with yourselves and also with Homer Green. But it's very hard for me to look at this job as me being a pastor and not think, wow, look at what King's Christian Centre helped me to grow, to become. So first of all, I just want to say thank you. And second, I want to just say that this is what investment does. This is what prayer does. This is what joining alongside people looks like, and this is what can become of it. So thank you so much. Thank you for everyone within the congregation at the moment, but also Andy and Sue and the rest of the leadership team. Thank you so much for investing in me, giving me that opportunity, giving me that mentorship, and really, yeah, help training me to pastor a church. So the passage I would like to share with you today is, as I said, from Luke 11, verse 5 onwards. And it says this, and I'm reading from the New International Version. Then Jesus said to them, suppose you have a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is always locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, he will Yet, because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, ask. Or actually, let me put it like this. So I say to you, ask shamelessly and it will be given to you. Seek shamelessly and you will find. Knock shamelessly and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you fathers, if your sons ask for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who seek him, who seek and ask him? So I wonder what prayer looks like to you this morning. Are you at a stage where in your relationship with God where your prayer life is going amazingly? Are you finding that your prayer life is very much just ticking a box? That okay, I've done my morning devotion, I've prayed this morning. I've given those couple of seconds or a minute or so to God this morning. Now time to get about what's really important today. And although we would never communicate it like that by words, we do it by actions. I think the little we pray shows the little we value prayer. And I think not just, and this is something I don't want to just put across to you, this is something that within my heart is important for me to really investigate and ask God to help reveal the areas in my heart in which I don't value communication with my Father as I should. Now, prayer is very important. It's very valuable. As Christians, it's a very fundamental part of our relationship with God. It's a very fundamental part of our communication. It's a very fundamental part of our relationship with one another, with our spouses. I wonder how many of us would get away with only talking to our spouses for a couple of minutes each day. I know I wouldn't. And to be quite honest, I wouldn't want Zoe to only talk to me a couple of minutes a day. I enjoy talking to Zoe. I love Zoe. And therefore, because I love Zoe, I want to know more about who she is. Keep getting to know who she is. Keep understanding her heart. Keep understanding where her views, her opinions, just everything about her. And also to keep just asking her things like, how's your day been? I think those are important conversations. And I believe that it's important for us to have this mentality in our prayer life with God. To say to God, God, I believe and I love you. And I believe that you have the best interest for me. And when we're able to do that, I believe that we're able to find ourselves in communion with the Most High and genuine authenticity, and genuine authentic relationship with God the Most High. Which brings me to my first point. We must be constant in our praying. May I put it like this? We must be constant in our communication, open lines of communication. Not hanging up in God and halfway our conversation because we've got something more, what we feel is more important to do. But to sit, to seek, to ask and to knock. To be persistent. To keep on seeking. To keep on asking, to keep on knocking. And not to just pray one and done, where we say, okay, I prayed this, that's it, I'm going to let it go. We see in the Old Testament of people who wrestle with God in prayer. We see people who fall on their knees before God and just present their requests and just like an open tap, just lets it flow and flow and flow. And that should be our mentality. That should be our heart, that we come before God and we just constantly, if I can say that, and I say this respectfully, just like annoy God with our prayers. Just, and although God doesn't get annoyed, he's a good father. I feel that that's what our prayer life should be, that if we were to communicate and with other people the way we do with God, it would annoy other people because it'll like change the record. But actually, in a relationship with God, I don't believe that God has ever said, oh, come on, Alan, change the record. Okay, Alan, I've heard your prayer for Zoe when she was in hospital. I keep hearing your prayer. I get it. You want healing. That's not who God is. That's not what God is about. God invites us into communion with himself. God invites us into relationship with him. So when Zoe was unwell, I could come before God and just weep and just plead with God for Zoe's healing. Time and time and time again. It's almost like writing lines at school. God heal my wife. God heal my wife. God heal my wife. And what about if we're praying for our communities? God awaken mold. God revive mold. God awaken our church. God, let your spirit fall in this place this morning. When Micah was a newborn, we knew when he needed milk because he yearned and screamed for it. And now that he's a little bit older, we know when he wants food. Because he communicates, although he doesn't communicate it how we would, he has his own way of communicating and he makes it known. So as his father, although I am sinful, and the other passage says, although I am evil, how... And I can still give good gifts to Micah. I can still feed him. I can still care for him and love him. Then how much more is God willing to do for us? So as Micah is constant, as newborns are constant, wanting milk, needing fed, needing changed, needing comfort, played with, so our heart should be like that as we approach God. God, feed me this morning. God, meet with me this morning. God, I've not heard you. I've not heard your voice. I've not felt your presence. I've not seen you move in so long. Please come. Spirit, let your spirit fall on this day. Which then brings me to this thought that when we do pray, we don't pray from a place of emptiness. We pray from a place of faith. And in Hebrews it says, without faith it is impossible to please God. Now I believe that faith is given to us as a free gift. So we have been given the gift of faith. And so if we've been given the gift of faith, then how much more can we be confident that God is going to move. That then brings me this to my next point. We must be confident in our praying. We must have confidence that when we do pray, that God is going to hear us. That when we do pray, God is going to, he might not always answer the way we answer. He answers. For example, with he answered my prayers with Zoe's healing and recovery. But I wonder how many of us, or how many of others, that God may have not answered the prayer in which we prayed. I wonder how many of us have prayed into an area of our life where we haven't seen God move, or we haven't seen God move in a way in which we wanted. I've always heard that God answers in three ways: yes, no, and not now. And I believe that. I believe that God answers in those ways, and I believe that it's important for us as Christians that when we do pray, we know that actually, God, I pray for this, but ready my heart to not receive this if it's your will. And I don't believe it's God's will to always give us what we want or what we need and what we desire, because sometimes our desire can be on things that are at immediate contradiction to his will. I also believe that there's times where God says, actually not now. When I left Bible college, I remember applying for pastor jobs, and I was getting no's, not now's. And for me, it's in hindsight, thank you God for not putting me in a job as a pastor at the age of 28 when I just left Bible college. Because for me, what I needed, what was required of me, was to go out and be mentored, to go out and to learn more, which I did. God opened a door at King's Christian Centre, in which I was developed, in which I was mentored, in which I was grown through friendship, through the love of every single person involved at King's, from leadership team to the congregation. And then I went to Homer Green, and the same thing happened. I was mentored, I was discipled, and I grew there. And then God has brought me to Hope Hall Evangelical Church. So what started off as no, not now, is now all his promises are yes and amen. They might not be yes and amen immediately, but just because a door hasn't opened doesn't mean that a door won't open. It means that sometimes God says, actually, you've not got the right key to that door, but I'm sending you to new places, different places, in which you will be able to gather that key to open that door. So we must be confident in our prayers, knowing that God is a God who listens. God is a God who hears us, who receives us, who speaks to us, and who has love for us. Whereas I want to bring this to a conclusion. What does your prayer life look like this morning? Now, normally, I was initially going to set up my camera to be at the pulpit and preach. And I thought, it's very hard for me to stand in one place. So I thought I would sit in my office chair and just preach seated, so that everyone gets to hear me and gets to see me without me jumping and dancing off the screen and on the screen. But I'm glad I'm here seated, because we are living in a time where we are seeing wars We're seeing rumours of wars. We're seeing famine. We're seeing natural disasters. We're seeing everything Jesus said that we will see as the signs of the end times. And if we are at the time of the, if we are in the end times right now, how does your prayer life look? How does your relationship with God look this morning? Do we need to repent this morning and say, actually, you know what, God, I have been so lazy in my prayer life? And look, I hold up my hands and say, there's times in which I go home and I know that God wants me to come, or inviting me to come and spend time with him in prayer and devotion and worship. But my brain goes straight towards, oh, I wouldn't mind a cup of coffee, a ginger cake, and a little bit of Netflix. Now, those aren't bad things. But I think when we sacrifice and substitute a relationship with God with our relationship with Netflix or other things, then what we are doing is we are creating, we're building an idol in our life. And for me, there's constant times where I have to chop down those idols in my life, especially when there's a good Netflix series, especially when it's around the World Cup time, whether that's in football or rugby. Although those things aren't evil, our hearts can end up elevating them in the place in which God should be. So who's the ruler of your heart this morning? And how can you shamelessly come to God in prayer? How can you fall on your knees and just weep out to God and say, you know what, God, I don't care how this looks. I don't care if people think I'm nuts. I don't care if other people in this congregation think I'm weird or crazy. I'm weeping out to you this morning, God, because you are my God. You're my Father that loves me. My Father that has the best for me. My Father who journeys with me and who has communion with me. Let's seek God shamelessly. I think if Jesus died a death, if Jesus stood up there with all the shame of our sin placed on him, but stood up there shamelessly saying, it is finished, then how much more should we fall down shamelessly and say, thank you, Jesus, for what you have done? Where is our boldness in prayer? Where is our confidence in prayer? How does our prayer life reflect the boldness and confidence in which God has given us? If it hasn't, and if it doesn't, then I think repentance is in store. Let me just pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for a time this morning where I got to share your word with this congregation, Father, with my friends, with my family. I thank you, Father, for the opportunity to preach from your word and to pull out those golden nuggets, Father, that are there to feed us, Father, for us to manifest on, to reflect on, to allow to feed our souls. And I pray, Father, that if our prayer life doesn't reflect that of Christ, if our prayer life doesn't reflect that of shamelessness, Father, then I just ask that may you convict our hearts and transform us. May you restore and renew us, Father. May you revive us this morning. May we become a people of prayer. May we become a people that is so in love with talking to you, Father, that prayer becomes like breathing, that is so natural. And I believe, Father, that prayer should be our spiritual breath, Father. And I just ask that may prayer become the spiritual breath of my friends and my family at King's, Father. That may when people speak in spirit, Father, it'll be like our natural, it'll be like our breath, Father, that it just comes so natural. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for, once again, thank you again for letting me be with you this morning, although not physically, but over video, recorded video sermon kind of thing. God bless. Bye-bye.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will. Nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you.
stare at the camera. Well, here we are again at the end of another one of our online services, and we pray and trust that you've been blessed through what you've heard, through what you've sung, through what you've prayed. Now, obviously, we love doing the online services, but we would love, even love more, to see you in person. So if you are able to make it, our services here in Mould are at 10:30 on a Sunday. We have a communion service at 10:30 on a Thursday. And we are just starting up a new weekly prayer meeting at 7:15 on a Tuesday evening. So if you're able to come to any of those services, you would be very welcome and we'd love to see you. As usual, there are resources on our website should you wish to investigate Christianity further. And contact details for our pastors, Andy and Sue, are on the website also and will be coming up at the end of the service. Liz is going to finish us off with a blessing.
Well, we're going to say the blessing together, but I'd also like to remind you that you can practice blessing people. And if you don't know what to say, you can always bless them. I said to Howard, I don't know how to pray for Mr. Putin. Maybe I should bless him. Well, wouldn't that be a turnaround if Putin became a Christian and called the war off? So try blessing people. And now let's say the grace together and bless one another that way.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen. Amen. We trust you'll join us next week for our next online service. Goodbye now.
Goodbye.